up. Thank you for coming today, and we hope to answer any questions that you have at the end. In terms of format, we just basically want to repeat our main allegations, and obviously we'll preface this. We're basing that on witness testimony and something we haven't been able to prove yet. In terms of the stuff that we're talking about, we'll be absolutely categorical about that. To start off, we have witness testimony that there was mismanagement at an agency that was under the aegis of the Glasgow East Regeneration Agency, called the Intermediate Labour Project. We have an eyewitness who says he saw the head of Employability Services at the Glasgow East Regeneration Agency abuse the ILM, which was funded by European money, basically to give out jobs and also to help a fund which a witness says was linked to some legal councillors bid for construction contracts on a cheaper basis than they'd been able to otherwise. The Intermediate Labour Project was a scheme for people ex-imprisoned coming out of long periods of homelessness and getting back into the workplace. It was the idea of an employability service funded by Europe. The second allegation that we can make about the same individual, this guy Hay, it's also based on witness testimony, but basically a complaint has been made to Audit Scotland about this individual, and the complaint alleges that board members on a charity that this man, gay man, were not real individuals. Basically there were fraudulent payments made, and based on our own investigations into that charity Diversity, we have uncovered that relatives of Councillor George Redmond, who also keeps us in the report, Councillor Frank McAvity, who is the MSP of the Peel Council, and Councillor Yvonne Cushick are all on the board of this charity. So that's our own investigations. In terms of the same individuals, we've got Councillor Redmond, Councillor Yvonne Cushick, and Councillor Frank McAvity and Ronnie Size coming up again in a range of commercial relationships. Now, we understand that when the payment that was made to Ronnie Size that Oscar, the charter's regulator, condemned as misconduct, that the council responds for the two councillors, Councillor Jim Coleman and Councillor George Redmond, were inexperienced in running boards. What we've uncovered is that these individuals have business relationships that predate the data folding up, which led to the running size there. So that they predate that and they post-date it. So ongoing commercial relationships between some of the key players that have been made here. The fourth allegation we made is that definitely not criminal, but we think it is misconduct. Basically, this has been in the public domain, but despite unfavourable impressions, to include the perception that David Crawford acted inappropriately, this is the former head of social work at the City Council, despite unfavourable impressions during the closure of the Accord Centre and also subsequent closures of daycare centres, David Crawford was given a very generous £600,000 severance package. And this is a time when the social work department is making very stringent cuts, we think that's totally inappropriate. Not illegal, but definitely wrong. And this, I think, our next allegation is a central allegation. And we believe this is a watertight case of malfeasance and very possibly criminal. The council department was Robert Booth, who ran land was involved in insider trading with his brother, who is a senior executive at Theridor, over the combined heating power plant at Holmenee, which is now a private incinerator run by Theridor. Freedom of information requests into the deal have been buffed, so it's all very vague. But what is clear is that someone who runs a department for the council, who has led a project to develop a centre for combined heating power, should not then sell that same council asset to a private company to do something completely different, basically run an incinerator. So that I think is clear cut malfeasance. And I pass it on to my colleague Andy.
Okay, the next allegation you have relates to the Freedom of Information Act response, which the campaign is sought for. This time it was in reference to the city's problem of homelessness. Now the council has a statutory duty to house, or the council systematically is coming to homeless people as a statutory duty to house, but there is no accommodation available. Our Freedom of Information response from the council showed that this occurred 23.8% of the time. So that's something that's a breach of Scottish Government rules. To pick that up is something which we would say is a pretty watertight allegation of practice. Next allegation we have relates to SECC. Now, SECC is a private company, it's a joint issue of the council itself, and according to one of the councillors that built themselves, makes a loss. Well, despite its loss making status, the firm has paid the highest salary of any public official this year. It's also made significant errors to councillors who have been on the board of the firm for less than 12 months. So, again, you have Councillor Benton coming up, who is aiming to charge over £10,000 for his leadership services to what was a loss making firm. Next allegation I have relates to Margaret Giaconelli and her treatment of the Commonwealth Games. Margaret, which was evicted from a loan block house in 2011, when it was compulsory purchased. Now, despite the fact Mrs. Jackie Ellis' homes are made over £98,000, the council told her that she had to accept only a £30,000 payout by way of compensation. But even years later, she hasn't received any compensation at all, was in fact mostly evicted from her house. Now, the campaign has been told by others in a similar position to Mrs. Giaconelli, they've not been able to come forward to claim compensation because of reprisals from the same councils. Now, again, we're being clear, this isn't something that we can 100% verify, but it's something which probably should be investigated as part of a wider culture into the council. We have had allegations along those lines. Next allegation we have relates to John Square. I'm sure most people have heard of that. It was extensively by the Herald. The fair itself led to a police investigation and a legal action against the council. And again, I think what the major case of mispractice there is the fact that this process cost Glasgow taxpayers almost £100,000. And again, we have some other allegations around the council going for more additional attention. In the past few days, our tourist issues have also been suspended for financial irregularities, and we also want to highlight the profiles of two councillors, specifically George Redmond and Sue Singh. We believe that they merit much closer scrutiny because of their various business schemes, their various connections, and possible allegations in our practice.
We mentioned Margaret in the course, she's also here with us today. I don't know if you'd like to say anything at all, Margaret. After Labour have were re-elected. That this is really stuff. This is stuff since Labour been re-elected. Now, we didn't initially set out to try and besmirch on anyone or attack the council in any way. Our campaign arose during the last election. We were involved trying to get promises from councillors, prospective councillors, on what they would do if they were elected. We didn't know who was going to win the last election. We called our campaign the 100 Promises campaign because Labour were re-elected and we felt we should continue the project of holding the council to account based on their often excellent manifesto. There's a number of promises in that 100 Promises which are absolutely amazing. Combined heat power was very much one of our core issues that we wanted to see dealt with. As you know, around about 2,000 people will die in Scotland this winter as a result of the cold. A great other population share will be in Glasgow. So this idea of having warmer homes, greener homes, great idea. And so it was when the payout to Ronnie Size was not accurately dealt with by the council. Not the one that asked to pay the money back. The two councils involved were told that they just needed more training. And essentially, the council slung a meeting at the report from Oscar. That piqued our interest and obviously we started investigating it, which is where we found that there are these commercial relationships between all the key protagonists in that story. And during that process, we heard about what was happening with Home and E. We were very keen on that being a gasification plant for combined heat and power. And when it became a private incinerator, we felt at that point the council's promises were being derailed by malfeasance of public office. And that was when we began this process of compiling this dossier. Now, I appreciate there'll be questions, so before we wind up, I'd like to take any questions. I formerly was in the SSP and in the SNP. What I will say is our campaign takes in people from every political party and no political party. You know, we've got people who are not interested in party politics, we've got people who are conservatives, we've got people who are members of the Communist Party, we've got all sorts. But this is about the council living up to its manifesto. This isn't the party political. Any other questions?
I think one of the key themes that comes through this manifesto is actually the suffering lifestyle. You've got Margaret Giacomelli there, thrown out of her home with no compensation whatsoever. You've got several councillors here making enormous profits out of hiring out substandard accommodation, making profits out of right to buy houses that should have been for ordinary people. And then at the same time, you've got three pages here documenting that the council is systematically telling homeless people that there's no accommodation available. Of course there's accommodation available. You can go to the Marriott, you can go to the Hilton, there's accommodation available. It's legal, a legal duty of the council to accommodate everyone that's homeless. And it's absolutely outrageous that they're getting away with making money out of these private lets when people are sleeping on the streets and being handed sleeping bags.
Good side.
Yes, I think that's right. I mean, it's clear that as a result of the changes that the Scottish Government brought in, all councils have a duty to house anyone who's found homeless unintentional, and basically that 23.8%, nearly a quarter of people who present as homeless and whose cases, according to Scottish law, should see them given accommodation of some description, are being turned onto the street. There is no overall absence in social housing in Glasgow. If the council wanted to address that problem, it's a question of money, and they're clearly not providing the resources, and they are in breach of the law, very substantially, in a way that is damaging vulnerable people's lives.
Can I ask a question? offence.
But it is the council, the landlords have done that because they know that the council is going to pay them. The council must introduce a cap on the rents, that there should be a cap on how much the maximum rent should be, and the landlord should not be able to charge that rent. This lady has been made homeless because of her state agent, and because the council does not say that there are no houses. But if there are no houses, then how do we see that there are so many two-leg signs everywhere in Glasgow? Every building we go, there is two-leg signs. So I think this is, again, I would say similar to what you just said, that this is outrageous and something has to be done.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's clear that this is a question of priorities. If the council are not meeting their statutory duties and other councils are, that's a question of the council deciding it doesn't want to meet the statutory obligations. And that, you know, that should be slapped down by the Scottish Government, and it's very clear.
So my name is Austin Sheridan, I'm the SNP councillor for Nelson. The reason that I came on here today is because of actually every council mentioned in this report that should be sent to us. Every council here should be sent. And a lot of it's focused in the east end of the city, so I think it's extremely important. And I came on here and I thought we could have paid stuff for it anyway, but this is the issue that I came to. And in terms of the water type allegations and it is around the possibility of criminal activity, how helpful have Basel City Council been in investigating these activities and councillors and other organisations you've worked with, and how do you feel that sort of myself as an opposition council, what trials do you think that are at? What steps do you feel that I should take in order to help expose things? Because honestly, I've been with Citizen Control, I'm doing my best to hold the administration to account, but at every turn, there's more cases put in place by the administration, and I'm always happy to hear suggestions on how you feel that we can be more effective as an opposition in the council.
Well, that's a very good question. In terms of how the council responded, well, long before we compiled the dossier, some of the people in this room were present at the time, we asked the council to come to a public meeting, basically to address some of our concerns, and they ignored our very polite request for attendance, didn't respond, and were very obstructive. So that was unhelpful, and certainly didn't give us a steer either way. It showed that they weren't taking the allegations seriously. In terms of what we want to see happen, I think it would be very positive if there was a public inquiry to clear the air, because, like I say, we have 12 allegations there, more or less, and they're all subsequent to Labour's re-election. So we know what happened before Labour were re-elected, that there was obviously the scandals around Purcell and so on, and Gordon Matson was the man to lead the change. We're still waiting on the change. So we need some kind of scrutiny from higher up, I think. I think a public inquiry is going to
Nick, the whole reason why I came today is because of the showman sign story, situation being councillors buying houses for £1. Look at this guy here, homeless case, you know what I mean? Needless to say, I'm paying having £1 in rent, you know what I mean? I'm a council tenant myself, and to find out that councillors are buying houses for £1, I'm appalled.
Yes, the sale of at that point, Glasgow City Council to say happened, I think, well over a decade ago, mm-hmm. and it was sold to him on the basis that he would renovate the homes.
Yeah.
He never got around to doing that. I believe they're all on Hack Hill.
Even on the bigger picture, you know what I mean? How many tenants in Glasgow are getting offered houses for £1? None.
Well,
that sounds like jobs for the boys, you know what I mean? It's for mm-hmm. them, them.
Well, there's certainly a case to be made there. But in terms of the recent stuff, one of the things that's come up is Superman saying was an unregistered landlord. Mm-hmm. He didn't register his properties, which is, you know, it's more than anything, it's against the rules, it's against the law. And he's come under scrutiny from a lot of different angles recently, and I think his affairs are very big. he is one of the councillors we mentioned that really does need some more thorough scrutiny. So, no questions?
Just in the reply to the colleague for the SNP, there is a problem quite a lot of points. And the issue of the
at that development to over 50%. So that was a great commitment from Councillor Lazak. and he went on to be re-elected. We, after the election, when it became clear that they had won, we thought, okay, our job of accountability doesn't end with the end of the election. The Hammers Manifesto, many of the promises are very good, and our focus, as I said, was on things like combined heat and power, which we saw as progressive and you know, something that we could rally people around and that would make a real difference. So we decided to focus on those areas of Labour's manifesto, and that's why we call that campaign the 100 Promises campaign. In the process of holding the council to account, it became clear that one of the areas which was making it hard for us to hold the council to account was that things like the Pomeroy gasification plant being sold to Viridor to become a private incinerator, going completely against published council documents, and the director of that department immediately retiring on a huge severance package. Stuff like that kept emerging, and we felt basically the best way to hold the council to account, the best way that they wanted to show solidarity with the council in implementing its policies, was to see these issues come to public light and to have a public accountable discussion about what was going on in our city. So that's why we published this report today. It's taken a long time to compile. We held a public meeting in George Redman's constituency in April to highlight these issues. The council haven't really acted. So we feel basically we've got no alternative now other than to call for a public inquiry and to put all this out in the public domain. Hope that answers your question. Any other questions?
It's not so much a question, it's a suggestion. I would like to suggest that a copy of this is sent to every councillor, or rather hand delivered to the city chambers to be put the councillors in pigeonholes to be collected. And the Easter saying that is that if that's done, it means every councillor is going to be holding the airport in the city. And any councillor that is unhappy about this can then raise it at the council meetings, because it's going to be public knowledge that say complaints have been made, and every councillor has a copy of
it. I think that's a very positive suggestion, and something we probably will carry on.
But can I just add on to that? The difficulty is with McCauley's suggestion is political. You can't just take a paper, go to the council and get a meeting on it. You've got to go through the parishes, you've got to go through the huts. It's almost impossible to get that even discussed in the city chamber.
Just for yourself, any councillor is allowed to submit questions to the council, and I'd be happy to send that question to the council regarding this meeting.
Well, that's what we have found.
So this will not be the end of this story.